Imagine a colossal energy machine, a reactor so big that it could power entire cities. Yet, designed with a ticking flow that in 1986 changed the course of history. This is the RBMK reactor, an ambitious project of Soviet engineering, a symbol of technological progress at its days, and the core of the infamous Chernobyl disaster. Today we will take you inside this machine to understand its design, its purpose, and how it came to be. The acronym RBMK stands for High Power Channel Reactor, and it represents a complex design that lies at the core of it. Its history started in the 60s, and over years there were several design generations, but the main design principles remained the same. Unlike most modern reactors in the world which use pressurized water, the RBMK is a graphite-moderated reactor cooled by ordinary water. Let's start from the inside. The reactor's active zone is roughly 7 to 12 meters in size and consists of nearly 1700 columns. These columns are assembled from graphite blocks of three different lengths. This layer of solid graphite slows down the neutrons released by uranium fuel, allowing them to sustain a controlled nuclear reaction. Each block has a round opening through which a metal tube passes at full height. This forms a technological channel. Well, there are several types of channels, such as control channels or reflector cooling channels. But most of them are fuel channels where the actual fuel rods are installed. The fuel rods are the main element, and each rod consists of two assemblies of 18 zirconium tubes filled with uranium pellets. All that is mounted on a shared steel rod, and in total one load of the reactor consists 189 tons of nuclear fuel. In simple terms, water is pumped through the reactor's channels to carry away the heat generated by nuclear fission. The heated water turns into the steam, which passes through a vast system of pipes and drives turbines to generate electricity. But in reality, the processes at every step are very complex, and moreover, nuclear fission creates enormous radioactive emission. This is why the active zone is surrounded by additional components called skins. At the very bottom, sitting on a powerful concrete foundation, is the 5-meter-tall scheme S, made of fixed steel to support the weight of the active zone. Above it is the scheme OR, a 2-meter-high cylinder that forms part of the reactor's biological shield and contains the lower sections of the technological channels. This is where the feeder water supply system is connected. Surrounding the active zone is scheme KZ, a shield made from 16mm thick welded steel with additional reinforcements. Then, around it, there are two more hollow metal reservoirs, schemes L and D, filled with water with a total height of 14 meters. These add extra structural support and also serve as site biological protection. Now, above scheme D is a large 3-meter-tall assembly called scheme E, nicknamed Yelena. Similar to scheme OR, it is a cylinder, but a larger, with a diameter of 17 meters. Yelena is one of the upper biological shields of the reactor and houses the upper parts of the technological channels. Atop this is one more assembly called scheme G. It consists of concrete and metal elements through which passes a vast network of cables connecting inner detectors to control equipment. The upper part of scheme G forms the famous mosaic-like floor of the reactor hull, which you can walk over. This floor acts as an extra shield against radiation, but its segment can be easily removed if something needs to be serviced or fuel needs to be reloaded. Next, we will explain how this happens. Finally, all this is surrounded by a sand shield and everything together is placed inside a thick concrete shaft. As you can see, there is no protective containment, and there are a couple of reasons for this. First, before the Chernobyl disaster, the maximum projected scale of a possible incident didn't include the destruction of the reactor's integrity. And second, due to its enormous size, constructing an effective containment back then would not be really possible. Moreover, because of its size, unlike modern reactors, RBMKs were assembled directly at the power plant site, installed part by part using a special gantry crane capable of lifting 600 tons. This crane still stands at the site of the unfinished Unit 5 at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant. But in reality, this enormous reactor is just one part of the reactor unit, and each part of it is equally impressive. One of the RBMK's most distinct features is the ability to reload fuel while still running. This is done with a large installation called a loading-unloading machine, mounted on a crane that moves above the reactor hull. With its help, fuel rods can be replaced without taking the reactor offline. Or their positions can be swapped from the center of the active zone to its periphery, and vice versa, because fuel burns unevenly. The reloading machine is really complex. It has a special revolving mechanism inside a hermetically sealed container, which attaches to a chosen fuel channel. And as we mentioned in our previous episodes, the exact method of rod placement is calculated by the SKALA computer system, based on a special program called Prisma. On both sides of the unit there are main circulation pumps, which are part of so-called system of repeatable force circulation. There are two loops in this system, so there are four pumps on the left and four on the right. One of the four pumps on each side is kept in reserve, while the others continuously drive water through the reactor's channels. It is difficult to comprehend just how large and powerful these pumps are. Each weighs 105 tons and is powered by a 5500 kilowatt motor capable of processing of 1800 cubic meters of water per hour. From these pumps, pressure pipes lead to a feeder collector, and from this collector, hundreds of thinner pipes are connected to fuel channels. Each one is equipped with a rotameter, which monitors the water flow and sends the data to the SKALA computer. Water passing through the fuel rods turns into steam at the temperature of 273 degrees Celsius. But because of high pressure inside, part of water still remains liquid, so what comes out of channels is a steam water mixture which isn't directly suitable for turbines. Therefore, another part of the circulation system handles the necessary separation. Using hundreds of tubes, the mixture is delivered to so-called drum separators. These are huge pressurized vessels with perforated metal sheets inside which separate the steam from the water. The excess water returns to circulation through special collectors, while the steam continues to the turbines. And now note these installations. So this is the system of monitoring the integrity of fuel rods, consisting of few automatic cards. While you can't look inside the reactor while it is running, you can detect problems by analyzing what comes out of the channels. So, these cards, equipped with spectrometry detectors, move along the pipes scanning the radioactive emissions and send this data to automatic equipment, which compares it with set points. If any fuel rod tube loses its integrity, fission products will appear in the mixture, triggering an alarm in the control room. As a side note, to fit the reactor's designed capacity, the drum separators must be really huge. But the steam turbines are even bigger, so there are two of them in each reactor unit, and each weighing 2800 tons with a power output of 500 megawatts. To maximize steam efficiency, each turbine has one high-pressure cylinder and four larger low-pressure cylinders. All this is capable of processing 2800 tons of steam per hour. The steam that passes through the turbines condenses and turns back into water. It passes through special filters, then through deaerators that remove air, and finally returns to the drum separators before circulating back to the pumps. At the Chernobyl nuclear power plant today, the turbines have been removed. However, back in 2010, I received permission to visit the turbine hall while dismantling was already underway. There I took these images, and here you can see how massive this equipment is. As we mentioned earlier, the processes inside the reactor are incredibly complex. So there is a vast network of detectors installed across the active zone, also there is other equipment, all gathering data that is later processed by the SKALA computer system. SKALA logs everything and provides operators with real-time information. The main control instruments are control rods, which are responsible for absorbing neutrons and slowing down the chain reaction. These rods are placed in special channels, which are also cooled by water from a separate system. At the top of these channels there are servo motors. Essentially those are electromechanical winches that use wires to raise and lower the control rods. In an emergency, it's also possible to manually rotate these servo motors. The gears of servo motor are mechanically connected to a cellsin, which sends position data to a corresponding cellsin display in the control room. In case of an emergency, the system of control and protection, called SUS, adjusts the configuration of control rods to reduce power in a controlled manner. But as we all know now, the RBMK story is forever tied to the Chernobyl disaster, which was out of any projected scale of maximum possible incident. The disaster exposed fatal flaws in its design, particularly how the reactor behaved during emergencies. Control rod design, positive void coefficients, combined with a very low culture of safety and systematic ignorance of problems all played a role in the events of 1986. And while said is subject for a separate episode, there is a high chance that if such a machine would be built in a country of a different safety culture, this disaster would never have happened. However, before the Chernobyl disaster, RBMK reactors were considered the future of nuclear energy in the USSR. They were even promoted internationally. And while the Soviets developed also other types of nuclear reactors, the RBMK was chosen mainly for its economical advantages. This led to the construction of numerous RBMK units, not just in Chernobyl, but also in Leningrad, Kursk, Smolensk and Ignalina power plants. And if you imagine that disaster would not happen, highly possible we would see even bigger version of RBMK. There were two design visions, so one included increase of power by changing the design of fuel channels, while the reactor would remain of the same size. This way was created RBMK-1500 at Ignalina nuclear power plant, but there were also projects with power of 2000 and 3600 megawatts. Another vision was to increase the size of the active zone and make it rectangular instead of round. This way appeared projects of RBMKP-2400 and 4800. And this number means their power in megawatts. And despite RBMK strongly associated nowadays with Chernobyl nuclear power plant, this was only one of possible initial options for its reactors. This is quite interesting subject, and about this we will tell you in our future episodes. We will analyze an original project of the power plant and the city of Pripyat, and we will see that the story could be completely different. If you made it this far, thank you for watching. Find links to bonus reading in the description, also check out our other documentaries because we have a lot of interesting things to watch, and see you next time in the next episode of Chernobyl Uncharted.